fat coming down like a horse. He jump up high and deliver. The ball come down like a thunderbolt and bust the bat into splinter. Liquid donkey, liquid crapo, liquid snake in the gully. Lick down giraffe and kangaroo and gone whistling down to the boundary. Well, red ants lie down flat on the ground. He say, Lord, that elephant crazy. He must be chinky, his coat me wash, or the man from Antigua courtly. And the ones in the crowd start to sing very loud if you hear them. Hit the ball, donkey, hit the ball. Cover, drive him and make him ball. Hook the man like Brian Lara and put him out the pasture. Scatteration out on the field, every man jack was hiding. Crapo lie down like if he dead, giraffe and kangaroo limping. But Mr. Parrot, the umpire, he said, all you hold some strength. Elephant, that was a low ball, donkey to bat again. The donkey turn wrong and watch Parrot. He say, Parrot, shut your mouth. You're behind safe up inside the tree. No ball, me tail, I out. And he turned to the crowd and he said very loud, let me tell you, all you're talking about, hit the man, but all your backside inside the stand. Send some other jackass to bat. This jackass finish with that. I'm writing to the West Indies port. The last thing's really dread. It's time for all you to say goodbye. You have me holding me head. People fed up with all your man, from St. Kitts to Kayaku. What all you have there is not a board. It's sawdust and crazy glue. You have cricket in confusion, no organized approach. We mention financial statement, or you scattering like cockroach. A fella tell me in Caroni, he giving all you a PhD. PhD in Oboli, all you take a rest. You're demoralizing I and I. You make Holden and Viv Richards cry. Greenwich cut up in maroon tie, all you take a rest. The free paper bun and we ain't making fun, all you take a rest. This old boy kind of bored from the colonial days. But now that we have nobody in charge, the jackass is free to graze. You're telling me to have patience, things will improve one day. But patience and she's sister hope, they migrate to Zimbabwe. I never see a board with such confusion, so many twists and turns. You fire Lara so many times, the man have third degree burns. The word all around the neighborhood, Bishop coming to abuse you good, Tony Kosha coming with piece of wood. All you take a rest. West Indians cussing you everywhere. A Barbadian lady declare, for them Harris and Cave and leave them there. All you take a rest. Hand over the bowling to Roberts and Holden. All you take a rest. Must answer to somebody, maybe Gypsy or Super Blue. A Kaiso man would give them tempo and tell them what to do. The players confused, the sponsors too. We build big stadiums for what? We don't have people to fill them up. Look out when they start to rot. The whole region is crying out, close down the puppy show. All you come like a bad headache, we just want you to go. Don't waste me time with no committee. Don't waste no more, they just sell money. Close the door, give me chill the key. Or you take a rest. You make one move, that is the cream. You
like a captain, not on the team. What all your smoking, it must be green.
Or you take a rest.
In fact, what they say may take or suck a supote. The West Indies board could not arrange to put three men on a plane. They fire a captain, hire him back, then fire the man again. The Guyanese will tell you by this poor lass in the bush. They don't want to resign, they need a little push. Let me put up signs all over the region, north and south, east and west. A simple message, four words, or you take a rest. Put a sign up on every door, Kingston, Bridgetown and Beau Séjour. A direct message they can't ignore,
or you take a rest.
It big on your car or truck, every building and aqueduct. Shame them into leaving the work,
or you take a rest.
Just lock up the office and hand me the keys,
or you take a rest.
Find out a workman, I begging you please,
or you take a rest.
You run the cricket ship on the rocks,
or you take a rest.
You make a rasta cut off the locks,
or you take a rest.
Time to sing praises to a great West Indian, a great sportsman, a great batsman. It's time to sing praises to a man from Guyana, a true superstar, our batting savior. Well, it's 2020, our playing test. He always gives his best. So come and join me, come on everybody, let's sing joyously. My boy Jacka, they just scout him. No matter who ballin', they can't control him. There's one thing about him, they can't outshine at all. Oh, 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 at all. Hey, 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 at all. Shanda bad for Peter, shanda bad for Paul, shanda bad for everybody. Shanda bad for all, shanda Paul, shanda Paul. They could do what they want, they got all the shanda the toll. They could do what they want, they got all the shanda the toll.
Man who deserve it, who protect his wicked, for West Indies great.
for Paul. Shanda bad for everybody. Shanda bad for all. Shanda Paul. Shanda Paul. They could do what they want, they got only Shanda the tall. They could do what they want, they got only Shanda the tall.
Fast or spin, keep bowling.
They could do what they want, they got only Shanda the tall.
Try leg break or googly.
They could do what they want, they got only Shanda the tall.
Sure to hit you for the boundary.
They could do what they want, they got only Shanda the tall.
Nobody could out it.
They could do what they want, they got only Shanda the tall.
Eat tiger, keep batting.
They could do what they want, they got only Shanda the tall.
The scoreboard, keep ticking.
They could do what they want, they got only.
Afternoon, everyone. It's when I came, first I was invited here by Professor Ian Boxhill, and we're going to talk about West Indies cricket, which I don't think. Oh, I have to say a very special good afternoon to the registrar at the University of the West Indies, who just happens to be my sister. just by the way, Dr. Camille Bell Hutchinson. She's going to hate me for this, but I'll tell you quickly. It's Camille Elizabeth, but as a youngster, I couldn't say Elizabeth, so I called her Lilibet. And believe it or not, I still do. So, hello, Lilibet. But the Center for Tourism and Policy Research, in association with the Department of Sociology, Psychology, and Social Work, and the Department of Government at, here at UMona, they present, it says West Indies cricket, not out, the way forward for West Indies cricket. So, as I said, in a nutshell, we're talking about West Indies cricket, the highs, and we have had some really, really wonderful stuff in recent times, the lows, the controversies. Hopefully, before we leave, we will maybe look at some solutions if there are things that are really wrong, and then maybe we look at what's going forward. We are also going to be streaming, so I guess I will keep this information for a little while until we're ready for that, but you could get us on WhatsApp and Facebook and Instagram and on Twitter and all that. So let me first introduce Mr. Ali McNabb, who is here representing the Honorable Minister of Culture, Gender, Entertainment, and Sport. I don't know if you know this, but Ali, an outstanding footballer for Cornwall College, for Jamaica, for Boystown, actually one of our national coaches. I say that because I can't remember if he was a cricketer, but he's here, and he looks to Wavell and says, tell him. Well, tell us, please. Also, Professor Ian Boxill is here and will come up in just a little while to say a few words. The former West Indies opening batsman and now the West Indies Players Association president, Mr. Wavell Hinds, sits immediately to my left. Beside him, probably the most cantankerous person in the entire world. Certainly in Jamaica, but probably in the entire world, sports commentator, Oral Tracey. Beside him, someone who probably is just as cantankerous, just a little older. been cantankerous for a little longer, I think. My very good friend, Mr. Horton Dolphin. He's so much into cricket manager. I was looking here and I says, cricket batsman. That I don't know anything about, but... And at the end of the table, Dr. Julian Cresser, who is a lecturer at the Department of History and Archaeology here at UWE, former St. George's College cricketer. We could applaud that. Thank you. But please welcome everyone, and I welcome everyone here. It is so great to have you. So again, we're going to be talking about West Indies cricket. First, let me congratulate the cricketers, the under-19s, the ladies, the T20 ladies, the T20 men. It's the first time I'm saying congrats to them. And I know they stopped playing it for a while, which is probably good because I don't think anyone would be listening to me. They'd be watching that. But the men, what a fantastic final over. I don't think I've ever seen anything like that to get the runs. 19 in the last over. We've had 19 and more in an over, but 19 to win in a last over, and in the end, winning quite easily. Damien, don't you think? Winning easily. 4 sixes. I've never seen anything like that. So please let us all congratulate the ladies, the youngsters, and the men. All right, so I'll be told when has the streaming started? It's up. So you could get us at WhatsApp, 573-2182, Facebook at UWICFPTV, all one word, Instagram at UWICFPTV, Twitter at UWICFPTV, hashtag Windies Talk. We also hope to speak with the outstanding cricketer, Sir Vivian Richards. We hope to link with the head of marketing and communications at the West Indies Cricket Board, Carole Beckford, Fazeer Mohammed, sports journalist and commentator. So hopefully we will be able to have a chat with all of them. But first, let me invite Professor Boxill to come forward and say a few words.
Good afternoon to everyone. Let me say this today, it's about cricket and about the panelists. I was not expecting to say anything, but I just want to begin by thanking the co-sponsors of this event. I see Heather Ricketts here, who is from the Department of Sociology, Psychology, Social Work. also Lloyd, well, Christopher Charles, who is representing Dr. Lloyd Waller. You know, when I broached the idea with both departments, they agreed immediately and came on board. And it took us about a week to put this together. And we are, I have to thank all of those panelists who have agreed, because it's something that, you know, I mean, West Indies cricket is, after the T20 victories, I remember there were three victories, and the female victory was also quite a good victory. You know, after that, there were many controversies which emerged, and we expect tonight that, and I mean, I was reading newspapers today, but I don't want to get into that. I'm sure some of these things will come up. But nonetheless, it's topical, but it's very important. Cricket is very important to us as a West Indian civilization. And therefore, we thought that it would be important to sort of engage in a dialogue which not only looks back, but also looks forward. And I believe that today we will get many interventions by persons who will not only diagnose what is wrong and what is and point to what is right, but also point to what we can do to make things better. So it's also about looking forward, as I said, and finding solutions. I want to thank Neville Belt, who agreed immediately to also moderate this panel. As he said, there are one or two very cantankerous persons on the panel. Horton Dolphin is cantankerous. He wouldn't tell you that, but he's also quite cantankerous, but in a good way, I should say. So we expect to have a very, very exciting event. I'm looking forward to the interventions, not after the panelists, from our global audience. We have audience all over the world, and I'm sure we will be taking questions from them following the discussion. So once again, thank you for joining us, and we look forward to having a very exciting and informative event.
Thank you, sir. And again, get in touch with us, WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. And if you have joined us, I guess good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Mr. McNabb, please, sir, representing the Honorable Minister, will come up and say a few words.
Good evening. I was at a forum, a cricket forum, where they opened a cricketing stand over in St. Thomas the other night. And they asked me if I played cricket. And I told them that they need to check their history. Because along with someone you most of you are all familiar with, which is Steve Bucknam, he and I opened the bowling for Cornwall in the Headley Cup. I was not a particularly good batsman. I was a reasonable bowler. I was excellent in the outfield because of my speed. And there's a particular mayor, I don't know if I should call his name, that is currently on the other end of the island. He went to Manning's High School when I went to Cornwall. And I bowled the opening over. Actually, the ball slipped out of my hand and crept along and bowled him for ducks. He has not forgiven me since. Bertis, you forgot to tell him that I ran for Jamaica in track athletics as well. So the minister wanted to be here today, especially so when she heard that Sir Vivian Richards was going to be here. I don't know why, because she has me with her. So I don't know why she'd want Viv. But they have a special connection. I think she opted out when she realized that Viv was not going to actually be here. So, no, but she is actually quite tied up. And she really asked me to come and really apologize, because she believes that this forum is a timely one. It is actually needed, and hopefully coming out of a noble institution such as the UWI, the powers that be, the players in the game, will actually listen, learn, and try to implement some of what is discussed and concluded here today. Mr. Ian Boxer,
Director of Tourism Policy Research. In his absence, Dr. Archibald MacDonald, Pro Vice Chancellor and Principal UWI. Distinguished panelists, I won't name them because they're all known. I found out something about old Tracey earlier this evening. And I look at him in a different light today. Reason being, today happens to be my birthday. And it happens to be his mother's birthday. So there is some good in Oro somewhere along the line. I can't stay with you, as you understand, it's my birthday. My big son, who Wavell knows very well, has invited me. His wife is Imega Breeze McNabb, who puts on the expo at the arena. And that's my excuse. So that will keep me out of trouble when I stay by my big son. But to the business at hand, on behalf of the minister, as I said before, she is sorry she can't be here. And she sent her greetings, and I'm going to read what she has said. Once more, it is my distinct pleasure to congratulate the male and female West Indies cricket teams for their outstanding performances at the ICC World T20 competitions and that of the under-19s as well. This forum provides an opportunity for us to look at sport beyond the competition, the heightened controversies and excitement, and to see sport as an important social economic commodity that can stimulate the economy of the community, national and regional levels. Sometimes in our enthusiasm, we seem to find it difficult to identify the real challenges versus the presented ones. So we kind of end up muddying the water and cannot see clearly what we need to find. With many of our sporting disciplines, cricket being no exception, we often do not seem to address some of the critical issues which require strategic thinking, strategic investment, and the introduction and implementation of developmental plans. The issue of ownership must be given primacy, as the athletes, sports personnel must be identified as equal partners. Unless there is respect and parity, then the business will remain lopsided and we will not reap the necessary benefits. All partners must invest in the product and do their fair share. If we do not invest in the development side and be willing to be patient to see it grow to maturity, then it becomes top heavy, with real foundation being weakened. The government of Jamaica is an important partner in the business of sport, and we take very seriously our role as investor, developer, and facilitator. Under the administration of the Honorable Minister, Olivia Babsey-Grange, the focus will be on the expansion of physical infrastructure and the creation of opportunities for meaningful employment and career advancement, with sports being one of the lead industries. Today, as we discuss the subject of cricket, let us not forget to be proud of our accomplishments, that of West Indies cricket, that of our men and women and their performances on the world stage. Sometimes, you know, it's easy in our fit of disappointment to forget some of our great achievements. So let us build on them and collaboratively embrace the demands for change. We live in a very dynamic world, and we must take on the challenges of changing our form in order to advance and not just survive. So once again, on behalf of the minister, we want to thank you for the opportunity to share some thoughts and to highlight the direction of this new administration. We look forward to the deliberation and some critical pathways to make our program a success. Thank you.
So as I said earlier, I don't know him as a cricketer, by what he just said also. The deputy principal is here. Sir, it's the first time meeting you, sir. And when I was told to introduce you, I said, what's his name? And they say it long. I hope I do it justice, sir. Professor Ishen Kumbakawa. Is that right, sir? Please welcome Professor Kawa. Well, you can clap me for that first.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, the distinguished ladies and gentlemen in the audience. The principal was unable to come and asked me if I could quickly run over and deliver his remarks. So I'm here very pleased to be able to do so. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this panel discussion on the future of cricket in the West Indies. Cricket has been a backbone of West Indian sports for decades. It is indeed an ingrained aspect of our culture, regional identity, and it represents the true spirit of our Caribbean people. Without a doubt, it is one of the few sports that bring us together as a community. As a region, we have endured many losses, but also many wins in this arena. Our combined team of exceptional athletes from across the Caribbean personifies true endurance, the struggle of losses, the beauty of wins that typify the common personal experiences of a region of people committed to the development and growth of our islands and community. The recent wins for both the female and male West Indies cricket teams in the T20 World Cup highlights the significant strength in the psyche of our people, which is, regardless of our past and the expectations of the future, always manages to emerge victorious as a community, and that we do have the ability to continue to achieve greatness. For these reasons and many more, a panel discussion examining cricket's ongoing influence on the Caribbean has become overdue. I'm therefore pleased to welcome you to this panel discussion, which I believe will certainly be a positive addition and will result in lively discussions on this very important topic. I thank the Center for Tourism and Policy Research for organizing this panel discussion, and for recognizing the importance of this sport. Thank you all for coming. Have a good evening.
Thank you very much, Professor Kawa. I'm told that we are joined by the head of marketing and communications via Skype, Carole Beckford. Ms. Beckford, are you there?
Good afternoon, everybody.
Hi. How are you?
Pretty good. Just finished day one of two of an event workshop where all the venues that will be hosting the upcoming Tri-Series and the tour of India, we have them sitting in a room ensuring that they meet the required standards, because some of the staff is new, and you know, we're just trying to put everything in shape. As you know, we're starting Ghana June 3, where South Africa and Australia will play in the Tri-Nation series along with the West Indies.
Okay, well, thanks for joining us. I think you know who are here with us, and in case you don't, the president of WIPA, Mr. Wavell Hinds, is here, Mr. Oral Tracey is here, Mr. Horton Dolphin, and Dr. Julian Cresser are here, and we have a room full of some wonderful folks who want to take part in this. So thanks for joining us. By the way, have you decided the venues for these tours that are coming up?
The Tri-Nation series was already decided, so that's Guyana, St. Kitts and Barbados. The official from India will be here at the end of this month. Just to confirm, we made some recommendations and we will just await the actual visits just for clarity to ensure that the venues are in fact satisfactory based on the requirements of the tours.
Okay, fantastic. You haven't missed too much. We've had a couple of...
I've been listening online, actually. The live stream is up and running. So
okay, fantastic. Right. Fantastic technology. So for the first part, we're going to have some... I don't want it to seem like I'm interviewing everyone here, but I will ask a few questions for the first part, get the panelists to give some views, and then we will get you, the audience, involved, and then we will get maybe, hopefully, I'm not certain what time, we will try to link with Sir Viv and Fazeer Mohammed. But we started by suggesting or saying that what a wonderful thing happened, Oral. Three victories. Were you surprised that
they won the 19s first, and then the ladies and then the men just really did as well as the West Indies?
Thank you very much, and good evening, everyone. Yes, I was surprised at the under 19s success and at the women's success, not so much the men's. We've had a good, strong T20 team in terms of our senior team for a while. We won the World Cup in 2012. We have depth in that this particular format of the game, and I was not awfully surprised. In fact, I when we lost the five of the four players from the original squad, confidence waned a little bit. But when I saw the quality of the replacements, the Brathwaite's and the other people, Simmons, who came back in, I thought. When I looked at the opposition, India looked nervous at home, and I thought it was always going to be between us, India, and Australia.
India looked nervous
at home from the start. They should have lost to Bangladesh. And they looked nervous playing at home. That's it's strange. But so basically, I was not very surprised, but I was surprised about the women's performance. I never knew the team improved that much. If had I been a betting man, I would never bet a dollar and then beating Australia in that final. It was 0-8 going into the final. The longer odds I thought was the under-19s. That crucial moment that changed the entire tournament. The moment that, as usual, we came on our own people very, very hard for playing within the rules of the game. Got everybody went crazy, as people tend to do. And I think that moment motivated that particular team. And I think it basically ignited this entire round of success, because the senior team members kept referring to the under-19 success and the way it motivated them. So it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
You're speaking about, what do you call it, the
man card.
The man card, yeah, the run out. I had no problem with it. No problem at all with it. I have a bigger problem with the wicket keeper, Josh Butler, in the senior men's final, picking up that catch off the ground and claiming it. Yeah. And nobody saw that as unsportsmanlike.
Dr. Yep. Cresser, what does that do for West Indies cricket, if anything, the fact that we won? I know it's a different format, a shorter format of the game. What does it do for West Indies cricket? These three victories, these three titles, these three wonderful titles.
Good evening, everyone. First of all, let me also add to what Earl was saying about the surprise of the under-19. Surprise of the under-19 team. Going into the competition, they had a very poor run of form in the warm-up matches. They actually lost badly to England in the first match. And with the help of the man card scraped by Zimbabwe. But obviously, as Earl is saying, it proved a rallying point, which to me tells you that success in sports is dependent on a number of factors. There's obviously infrastructure, coaching, development, but there are also other emotional factors that are very important. I think what the three victories will do certainly is a motivate a lot of youngsters to continue playing the game. And that is a very important thing. I've been to many of the clubs, I've been around the clubs, I've seen in many cases interest waning in the last two decades. Something like this, I think, first of all, is important because it provides motivation, it gets people excited. Another thing that is important is that it provides leverage to the administrators of the game to seek sponsorship. And that has been one of the problems that has affected cricket, especially at the local level, at the club level, at the level of Jamaica Cricket Association. And I think when you have success like that, that provides leverage, and that is very important. So I mean, right away, as a quick answer to what does this do, is that it provides a feel-good factor, which is important in motivating people to play the game. But it is also leverage for those who are organizing the game to try and get people on board. One other thing that I'd like to throw in is that this is really success in limited over cricket. I've heard, obviously, since the late 90s, people constantly talk about a crisis in West Indies cricket. One of the things that I think we need to sit down and seriously think about is whether there is a overall crisis in West Indies cricket, or if the crisis is related to our attempts to continue with first class and test cricket. Because obviously there is something that is going on that is working for the shorter formats of the game. If you look, for instance, on T20 cricket in Jamaica, whereas the Jamaica Cricket Association is struggling to get sponsorship for it, Senior Cup cricket, where if you go to a Senior Cup match, there's hardly anybody there. You compare that with the SDC T20 cricket, which is kicking off this weekend, I believe, and there are over 200 clubs that are registered to take part. There's a tremendous amount of interest. I happen to work with one club in Clarendon, and there's community interest because the teams mean something to the communities from which they come. There's excitement, there's attendance, and there are certainly sponsors. So when we examine this crisis, as we will tonight, that is something to bear in mind. Where exactly is the crisis?
Yeah. Sir Horton, there is a crisis?
It all depends on how you spell that. I don't know, it's probably past that time. Bertus, by the way, good evening, everybody. It's a crisis, but it's something that is not beyond us in terms of solving it. Because when we look at the successes that we've had, I'm sure Wavell will bear me out on this. I don't know why Oral was so surprised with the under-19s. Because as far back as I can remember, and this includes when people like Wavell were playing under-19, we were always in the position to bring home that trophy. It was just a matter of time. And let us give credit to the board. The West Indies board, they don't get much credit these days. But let us give credit, because in terms of all three competitions that we won, there were significant camps that took place leading up to these competitions. I certainly had, my friends who are here from the senior common room will tell you, I called it very early, but nobody would bet me. I drove all the way from St. Elizabeth after we had done the double on Sunday and came to the club, and they were all hailing me, but I didn't want their drinks nor their hailing. I can deal with that. I wanted their money, right? And in terms of the crisis, right, this is part of it, the money thing, right? I told you all of that to tell you this. The money thing has created, a bit of a crisis, but this particular forum here this evening, I think it's timely, because when we look at West Indies cricket, you got to look at it. There are three pillars, of what we call West Indianness, and this is West Indies cricket. They started it, the University of the West Indies, and CARICOM. And I think it's time, I think it's time that the university got involved.
Yeah, I think we already wanted to.
I was just saying that CARICOM shouldn't be on that list. I don't think it works. Right. It doesn't work as well as the other two institutions.
Yeah, we'll come to that eventually. But I think it's time that the university got involved.
Okay. Sir Horton, you made a point, and you were saying that it is about money. I'm now told that Sir Vivian Richards is now on Skype. Sir Viv, can you hear us?
I can hear you, but I'm sounding a little blurred.
Okay, so we're going to try to fix that. This is Bertis, by the way, Sir Viv. I've been seeing you for a long time.
But I could hear quite clearly a statement made by an individual on your panel who suggests that in terms of what the kids are going after today, it's all about maybe the shorter version, and we are pretty great at that. I think we are superstars where these particular format is concerned. But one got to remember, West Indians, when we all started out to venture into the game itself, it was about playing cricket. We had test match cricket. We also had, I must remember that the one day stuff was introduced, you had the 60 overs, you had the 65 overs, and then you had 50. So, to be fair, I guess West Indians could play any time of cricket. So, I know today it's the stuff which I think because of the IPL, the huge T20 tournaments that's around the world,
It is an attraction. But as West Indians, when we started out not thinking about whether we're going to be a one-day cricketer or not, but becoming a cricketer.
Yeah. Sir Viv, it seems like people think there are so many problems, but if I asked, what would be the biggest problem in West Indies cricket?
I think it's the management and the governance, and we cannot run away from that.
Management as in the West Indies Cricket Board?
Board from whatever it is. Let us be clear. Okay, you may have a president who means well. He may mean all the good in the world, but then sometimes you have some very incompetent individuals who are representative of that particular organization. And there are times that individuals would have dropped the ball on numerous occasions. And I've always felt, and anyone on that panel is going to tell me that we didn't have a problem where communication and the communicating factor, players and management and the people who are responsible for West Indies. If anyone tells me that there wasn't any problem, well, I'm not quite sure which way we're living. But we have got to understand that there is a problem where management is concerned. And I've seen it at a level where you have individuals at board level think they're just as personalities as the players. And it's the other way around. And you've got to find a medium where you can manage these individuals well enough, because these are the revenue earners. Let's not forget that.
Is there a suggestion that because if you are right, that the management is not right, is that the reason we haven't done well in the test arena and maybe in the 50-over game in recent times?
Maybe. We don't look for excuses. What we got to create the platform, I guess, that makes it inviting, exciting for every player who wants to put on the maroon cap or wear that particular maroon.
Yeah.
It is, and we have seen it. We have seen all the problems that we had. And let me say also that whenever you have a captain and a captain would have failed because he was appointed by the selectors to get a job done and it's not done for a period of time, you're looking for the alternatives, aren't we?
Yeah.
So let us look at the ways and means maybe going forward as well, where we can find a medium where, because of what went on in the past, the personality clashes. What causes these personality clashes? Because we have got a wonderful foundation now, as you guys would have mentioned what took place earlier, the under-19s success, the women, the men doing that later on as well. So we have a wonderful platform now to try and find out how we can try and incorporate our players in some of the other tournaments that they're not doing well because of this success.
All right. We want to welcome everyone again. I know folks are coming in as we speak, and we're streaming. WhatsApp 5732182 if you want to be a part of this, and Facebook UWICFPTV, Instagram at UWICFPTV, Twitter at UWICFPTV, hashtag Windies Talk. And we're here talking about West Indies cricket. Wavell Hinds is the president of the West Indies Players Association. I saw today that the West Indies wicketkeeper, Dinesh Ramdin, says he thinks you should step down because you are not negotiating as well as you could for the players. I won't ask you if you think you should step down. But I think you would agree that it must be to the players' benefit to be a part of the Players Association. And if you do agree with that, then why, I think in the T20 team, one player, it was said, would be a part of your organization. So why would they not want to be a part of the organization? What have you heard from them, or do you have any personal thoughts on why they don't want to be a part of the organization?
Good evening, everyone. Very good question. I think it's important that all the players are a part of the association. I certainly believe that what we try to do is to try to negotiate for everyone, just to educate the public on the fact that we have in excess of about 350 members to 400. And of course, in my mind, from when I was young playing under-19 cricket to date, I still believe that the human resource, the players, are the most important resource that the West Indies board will have. Having said that, if we're trying to move cricket forward and we're going to look at it in a very holistic way and look at it realistically, we also having our ranks on the women, and we brought them on board in 2014 August because they were by themselves doing their own negotiation, and we are very proud of that move. What exists in the renegotiation of the CBA MOU from with the WICB existed in 2014 February. We had an AGM and we discussed those matters, and it was put on the table. Mr. Michael Hall was the person who crunched the numbers, and we had a very, very long meeting in the then Crown Plaza Hotel in Trinidad and Tobago, at the Port of Spain. And we all agreed what was necessary for West Indies cricket. There are different points that were discussed. There are players and members who believe that the first class season was too short. There are members who also believe that the backbone and the bedrock of West Indies cricket lies within first class cricket. And if we didn't get first class cricket right, of course, coupled with the development of the youngsters, then our cricket will be basically a recurring decimal, and we just be entering competitions, participating, providing media content, not good content, career and winning, and certainly just hopping along, kicking the ball on the road, but not necessarily fixing the issues. Part of the responsibility of the Players Association, of course, is to first and foremost look out for the welfare and well-being of our members, but we also have a responsibility to protect and look after West Indies cricket. If we don't do that and look only solely for the members, then I would suppose in a couple of years the members won't have any cricket to play and they won't be in jurisdiction. So in saying that, we moved in trying to negotiate with the WIC to have a franchise system to try and move the cricket forward. We at that time would have had one system that worked for 88 years, had its success. We certainly have survivors on online, and we welcome that, and you would have tasted success in a very big way before he was captain, of course, and while he was captain. And those are things that makes our legacy very proud, and we're proud of that. But you need, in the changing times, the landscape of the game has changed, and certainly the West Indies needed to move in that direction. When we did our assessment of world cricket, West Indies was probably the only nation, as full members, who weren't playing a professional. So I didn't have a professional setup. We had amateurs playing professional competitions, as you need to play and stipulated by the ICC. So we rack up some guys. We play a competition from January to March, maybe April, and then in October we'll have a one-day competition for about 10 to 12 days, and off you go. You play three games. If you get through, maybe this October it starts raining. The rain may get 2 or 1, they end up getting a game. But you are expected now to make a one-day team from that competition to go and play against the world champions and win the World Cup. I guess Survive and others did it then. They had the privilege of playing county cricket and continued to develop them skills, went over to Australia and play cricket. We know what happened in England in terms of our players going over to county cricket. Those opportunities were numbered and restricted based upon the red tapes that were placed there. So in what we have to do is try and create our own professional competition, our own professional leagues that will certainly develop our members. We've got the talent, we've got the raw material. We need the skill set from the teachers. We have developed coaches in the Caribbean. We have past players who I believe, not because they're not certified, I believe that they're qualified. And they may not have the certification on paper, but I think that because they have been in the trenches and I would have done it on the world scene for 20 years, they certainly know what to do. We have those. So I think in putting all those stuff together as an executive and as a body and having continuous discussions, we thought the best way to go was a professional way. We put that to the membership, we discussed it, we went down to the numbers, we crunched it. Persons had different ways of going about it. At the end of the day, with a lot of suggestions and other things, it was put to the vote by the membership, and it was agreed unanimously that this is the way to go. After that discussion was had, there was one qualification, and the qualification came from our senior members, and you will understand why, because they were pretty much engaged, had tied up in contracts with international franchises around the world, and they put it to the membership as well to discuss that they needed to be given the opportunity to play. They also accepted that if we're going to go to the new franchise system, which would allow an additional 90 guys to get contracts, to play locally and stay for 12 months and play in the Caribbean, then there'll be a reallocation of the funds which will impact on their pay package for international games. That was accepted. Now, the qualification came in trying to mitigate against that or somehow to make up the shortfall where that will concern. And the guy said, please negotiate and discuss with the WICB to have the rescheduling of our first-class cricket. So no longer do you start in January and finish in April. And no longer do I have to come back from where I'm at and play in October. Try and get the competitions to be running into each other or run concurrently if it's possible. So we took that on board and we got the mandate from the membership. And as I've always done since I joined the West Indies Players Association executive in 2002, which is to carry out the mandate of the membership. We did that. We negotiated the contracts. We got 90 new contracts for first-class players. We still managed to get 15 contracts for the international players. The contracts for the international guys had three categories. We negotiated to have five categories. The contracts were the three categories that predates February 2014, where A would have been $120,000. B would have been $100,000 and C would have been $80,000 per year for contracts. When we renegotiated the contracts, we had five categories. We had an additional A plus, which is $150,000. We had A, which is $135,000. We have B plus, which is $125,000. We had B, which is $115,000. And C, which is $100,000 per player. Whomever is in that category for 12 months of the year.
I picked up the phone not to use it or get a text message, but to read exactly what Ramdin said. And he said, Ramdin said Hinds, through his salary negotiations with the West Indies Cricket Board, had let down everyone, and as such, should step aside. If what you're saying, and I don't disagree or disbelieve what you said, why would he say that?
First thing, I don't know. I've not spoken to Mr. Ramdin since maybe last year, May, when we had a retreat in Barbados. But he probably would need to explain and define some key terms in that statement. What is let down? What does he mean by let down? What does he mean by everyone?
Yeah.
Because everyone doesn't necessarily mean the ones who put on the West Indies maroon cap or uniform to play for the West Indies team. Yeah. The negotiation was about the membership. When we call an AGM meeting, we don't only invite West Indies international players, we invite the members of the association. And when the meeting is duly called and persons attend and there's a quorum, which we only require 15 persons to our quorum, and we start the meeting and have a full discussion and matters are put on the table, and it's an open meeting and persons are allowed to have their say, and the meeting is populated with different members stating their claims and putting their positions forward, then when those are had, including Mr. Randins, he was a part of the meeting, and we come to a decision, I and the executive that I lead, we only have one option, which is to carry the mandate. Now, that was had, and let me just fast forward it to 2014 October, when the guys were in India, and felt that it was not fair, because they didn't like what was happening. And I could understand some of the guys saying that, because they are not members, some opt not to come to the meeting. Now, the institution that I lead is governed by a document called the bylaws. And the bylaws speak about each member having one vote, as I guess we would have been with our national elections in Jamaica. So whether you're a senior member for 40 years or you're there for 4 days, you have one vote. And when the decisions are made, it's binding on all, whether you come or not. You have an option to send a proxy if you want. You could maybe send an email or two to the secretary to state a position or not. But that is the reality of the situation.
Forgive my ignorance. Can anyone else negotiate on behalf of the players?
Well, I don't know if the Westerns Board will speak to them. The MOU and CBA that we have now speaks to one one negotiating team that the Westerns Board speaks to, one union, one body, which is the Players Association.
Can they negotiate on their own?
And that not to my knowledge. So I am just saying that is the situation. So Mr. Randin was present at that meeting. Mr. Randin and did not utter a word to say that he had a challenge with what was decided. There was no dissenting voice in the meeting,
okay.
None. Not to cut you, I just want to complete the point,
sure.
That to fast forward to October, there were issues and the guys decided that they they wanted to take this to the board and to, something has to be done about it. The Western Strip Board, we all know that it, they had a task force which spoke to what should be done and what shouldn't have done after the India tour. We said we are open, we are for the players, we are not against the players. We, I think our first goal is to look after the players. I'm open and fine. We want to go out to the table and discuss it to the WICB and include some of the issues the guys said they have. We did that. We are here in Jamaica, the Jamaica Pegasus for about 4 days, and we included independent parties. Mr. Brian Young was chairman, who is from Ernest & Young. There's also the ICC, had a representative there, and FICA had a representative. FICA is the Federation of International Cricketers Association, of which we are a member body, that's our parent body. And they had discussions, we had discussions for 4 days, the WICB were represented, and so of course were WIPA. And we had discussions, and we had agreed, and the mediator says we had signed off on what was agreed. That was taken to the retreat of May 2015 in Barbados, which had the selectors, board members, the secretariat, management team, franchise CEOs, franchise captains, the West Indies team that was preparing to play against Australia in the Test Series, which in fact had Mr. Dennis Ramdin in it as well. The document was presented after renegotiation with ICC, FICA, and Mr. Young. Those are the three independent persons who signed off. And Mr. Ramdin agreed that he's in agreement with it. No dissenting voice again. Now, to see the papers today is another matter. I don't know what Mr. Ramdin's issues are.
I want to get Mr. Dolphin's comments because we have to
With particular reference to the question you attempted to ask Wavell about the beef of the Big 14. A question was put in an interview that was held with the CEO, Mr. Muirhead, and he said that if they don't want WIPA to represent them and they can form a body, right, they can bring to the board and say, well, we have formed a body and we want to be represented by these people, that the board would probably give it consideration.
Carole, I don't know if you're still with us, but is that on the cards?
Is Carole Beckford still with us?
Hello? Hello?
Sir Viv, are
can
you
I
still...
ask a question, please?
Sir Viv, are you still with us?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm just wondering if I could ask Wavell a question.
Sure, go ahead, please.
Yeah. I know that Wavell and the past president did have some success against the West Indies board, in terms of some of the grievances that they took to the board itself and had some victories. I would like to know from the present president now of Wavell, what's the relationship now with Mr. the past president?
Well, I would say that we haven't spoken as often as I would have. We last spoke via, I think, Skype in summer of 2014, and we spoke last year. Well, we had communication through emails on an internal matter that he was trying to ventilate. So that's the nature of it, and that's where the relationship was. I just want to state, though, that Mr. Dinan Ramnarayan resigned from the association in 2012, March 21st. I became president, albeit on April 1st. Mr. Martin, I will like that date. All Fools Day. And of course, as a provisional president, I got my own mandate in 2013, I think January, but the minute I became president, my first duty at that time, given that I was now taking over the task of having been the vice president for 6 years under Mr. Ramnarayan's leadership, and 4 years prior to that as his treasurer, that I would have brought him in as a consultant, given that the sort of knowledge that he had and the kind of information that he would have had and the know-how, that we didn't want to lose that sort of talent and the wealth of knowledge and experience immediately after he departed office. So I thought that was a move by our executive to bring him in. We had him there for a couple of months as a consultant. He would have guided us along the way. So there was no ill feeling towards Mr. Ramner. And we had a very good send-off for him at our awards dinner in Trinidad and Tobago, giving him a big award for 10 years of human service to our association. So I think I still believe in a lot of the principles of Mr. Ramner, and I stand firmly behind what I did as his vice president, and will not in no shape or form denounce anything that I did then. At the time when we did what we did, I thought it was necessary. The association was not respected by the WICB in my mind, and certainly we had to make decisions to bring to book what we thought was some form of respectability to what we are trying to what we were trying to achieve. And I think that respect has been exercised on a pretty regular basis. As you are in a movement, and when the struggle is real, you also have to recognize when there are steps being taken to improve the relationship. And I think that step is made by the WICB. When you have fought for something and you have achieved it, then you want to move to the next phase. And the next phase is to try and make sure that we pull our talents together, move our ideas together, not losing sight of our core function and who we are responsible for and what our responsibilities are and who they lie with. But having said that, I think we have to operate within a scale of things that will speak to the development and improvement of West Indies cricket. I think the executives that have served on have done that to date. And of course, we operate on the mandate of our membership.
President, I keep hearing hello. Are you hearing us, sir?
Hello.
Yeah, I don't think.
Hello.
I don't think he heard many of that. So we'll try to correct that first. The president is sitting right beside you, Carole. Is WIPA still relevant?
I think we're coming out of it. I think
we're
losing.
All right. Is WIPA still relevant? Yes, WIPA must be relevant. It's the player's representative, the official representatives, and the kind of issues that Wavell, that his body is having now with the players. I think it's typical worker-union relationship, worker-union management relationship. I wanted to ask a question about this. I'm curious. Why are we having this kind of postmortem at this point in our cricket? When we just had the biggest period, the biggest moments of success for the past 30 years. Yeah, why does it feel now like we're presiding over the death of West Indies cricket when there is, for the past 30 years, the brightest lights we've seen in this game for the past 30 years? Why are the discussions taking on a tone as if this discussion should have been taking place maybe 10 or 15 years ago? Right now, I think we have a platform to move forward.
So you're suggesting we just back up
and move? I think we should back up and start. You see that segment a while ago? Yeah. We should just leave it out of the whole thing. look here, this T20 success was monumental.
Yeah.
And I think I heard the word crisis mentioned.
No, I accept that. But
I don't think we have a crisis. I think we have an opportunity.
I accept that, but I have to disagree because I think we have deep problems in West Indies.
We've always had problems.
Which is the reason we are
we've
here.
We've always, I'm probably a little bit younger than you, but from Iban, West Indies have, the players, they have always had problems with the board.
Yeah.
This is typical stuff, you know. This is the kind of problem where every employee have with them boss.
We had a question. I got it over there again. We had a question from one of our Twitter followers, Delhi, and Dr. Cresser made the point about SDC cricket here in Jamaica that draws so much people to the game. It's so exciting. I go back to Dr. Cresser. Can the West Indies cricket board take anything from what we're doing here to Bromley Hill in any way?
The discussion that I really wanted to have this evening starts from not what's going on with WIPA and West Indies Cricket Board.
Me too.
Not necessarily what is going on with just the state of West Indies cricket, but I think the point I was making earlier, a really serious question needs to be asked by the ICC about the future of the game. I think the topic is the way forward for West Indies cricket, but ICC has to ask questions about the way forward. There's obviously been a dramatic shift in how cricket is organized with the emergence of all of these domestic T20 leagues. And right about now, there's clearly some effort to preserve first class and test cricket. Now, I grew up on test cricket. I love test cricket. I don't particularly like T20 cricket, but certainly I will watch when West Indies is playing, and I rejoice in the success because it is West Indies. I've been to every single four-day match at Sabina Park this year, and it is me, Dr. King, and 20 other people.
Exactly.
Right?
Smell the coffee. Smell the coffee.
So the first thing is, I think there has to be a very serious question, which is, who exactly are we trying to keep Test cricket alive for? Right? There's obviously still interest, but it is something that we're thinking 10, 20 years down the line, we have to answer that question. Because if we then now apply that to the West Indies situation, a large part of the problem that we have in terms of when the discussions on the crisis of West Indies cricket emerge is, A, the state of the test team, and even to an lesser extent, the 50-over team. And what are we going to do about the regional competition? What the board has tried to do, and obviously with some support from the Players Association, is say, how can we ensure that this first-class competition can not just survive but thrive? If that is the goal, then clearly what the West Indies Board has been trying to do in terms of a redistribution of funds is a good thing, if that is the goal. Of course, that leads to problems because now the players who have long received a lot of money are receiving a lot less. If the goal is going to be, listen, we need to keep first class and test cricket alive, which may be somewhat idealistic, then the idealist in me says the solution is there's going to have to be some compromise. The idealist in me sees the West Indies Cricket Board as genuinely trying to ensure that there is a survivable first class league by providing contracts for 90 professional players. It is a board that is coming to the players to say, listen, in order for this to work, we are going to ask you to make a bit of a sacrifice and play in the regional league, because remember, part of the discussion now is the eligibility rule. We are going to ask you to play in the local competitions, but our compromise is we are not scheduling any cricket during IPL, which will allow you to make the biggest bucks. But we are going to ask you perhaps to give up some of maybe one or two of the other T20 leagues around the world.
I'm going to have to jump in because we have Carole Beckford back online. And we also want to get some comments, questions from our folks. And I'm going to pick up, you know, what Devin's son represents our team, Jamaica. This is Damien King, my good friend. Any thoughts?
Thank you, Burgess. One point I want to make, and it connects the beginning of the discussion with what is coming out now. Horton made the point that he was not surprised that the under-19s won the World Cup, because if you go back through this entire period when the West Indies have been struggling at the test level, they always do well at the under-19 level. They make it to the quarters or the semis. And what is interesting about that is that all of these players that do well in the under-19 tournament, when you roll forward 10 years later, most of them are not even playing cricket. It's not that they are playing cricket and they are not as successful. They are not even playing cricket. So what it tells you is that there's no talent problem, there's just a development and organization problem, that we are losing the players. And the reason why that is connected to what is the way forward is that the professional league that has been introduced solves that problem. It gives the players, after they get past under 19, a reason to continue playing cricket. So whether it fails or succeeds, it precisely addresses what is the key problem with the lack of development that we've had all along. That's the only point I want to make.
Thanks, Damien. Carole, are you back with us?
Yes, Neville, I am.
The talk is, and I think, I can't remember any West Indies president that everyone did say should step down, should resign for one reason or the other. I think Mr. Cameron is getting it a little bit more than maybe previous presidents. Carole, when you hear that, what are your thoughts? When you hear, it's almost like they're saying the problems in West Indies cricket is Dave Cameron. What do you say when you hear that?
Let me tell you, Neville, I think for the last 40 years, there have been several calls, I mean, for a step down from various people, the selectors. I remember being at the Pegasus some years ago. Michael Finley was head of selectors. He didn't pick somebody. I mean, I've seen our players have problems walking through the airport because they figure that players should have made a point and all those issues. But what I really want to say, though, in the context of 2016, having won three, you'd have seen the article in the Gleaner yesterday. We took the big three for tea. And I'm happy that the university has decided to come on board, because this is exactly what we want. The Mona School of Business is the equivalent of what Wharton Business School from the University of Pennsylvania is. I want to see research that suggests that cricket as a sport in the Caribbean must be forecast and trend towards the following. So that's the research side, which speaks to the fact that this is one sector, though unrecognized by the same governments that are criticizing the board, that none of these governments have decided that sport is a driving sector for our fledgling economies. And until we do that, all the development issues that we faced it in track and field. It wasn't until MVP and racers decided to solidify themselves that we have made a transition from high school sports to Olympics. And we know that story all too well from Jamaica. The PCL and the expanded one-day tournament that we have had over the last 2 years, as Dr. King just said, is exactly what the development needs. We can't continue to use 15 men and 15 women, in this case 11, to carry the bulk of our cricket. We must make it open. And a conscious decision was taken by the current administration over the last 3 years to do just that. And I am saying, I don't want to use crossroads. It is an opportunity for us to go forward. When I do the math, we had 3 one-day tests in 3 countries and we generated $60 million. In spite of how much rum we drink, rum don't sell as much as cricket generates to the Caribbean economy. we have to see what 2016 brings. And I'm saying, gentle people, yes, there are relationship issues and there will always be. Disputes are exactly what they are, relationship issues. Maybe we need to have less player on retentions. Maybe we need to create free agencies, as Julian Cresser suggested earlier. It needs a new dimension. The current relationship exists only until, I think, May or June this year. And there's a new a set of meetings to take place in the summer and will take us into next year. We are looking at pay disputes experts. We're looking at other sports that have been successful. It is a time for us to see this as an opportunity to move ahead. We mark ourselves very hard in this region with the little resources that we have. And I disagree with trying to mash up the thing as opposed to trying to build it to move it forward.
All right, let me jump in again. I don't think Mr. Dolphin will agree with that rum talk that you had. Sir Viv, are you back with us, sir?
I'm still here, very interested in listening. Sir, some very interesting answers and all that sort of stuff, you know.
Sir Viv, let me ask you a question, Sir Viv. Let's look forward. Tell me what you think should happen in West Indies cricket. What should happen?
What should happen?
Yeah. Because Hello? We're yeah, are you hearing us, Sir Viv? All right, seems like he's gone again. Anyone else here with a question, by the way, or a comment? Sure. Just give us your name and the question or the comment.
Yeah, my name is Claremont Curtin. I want to propose, since, and I support Mr. Tracy's suggestion, let us look at the way forward. I would like to propose that the people of the West Indies buy shares in a company called West Indies Cricket across the region to fund West Indies Cricket, and in so doing, also select the management of West Indies cricket as shareholders. I would like to hear the views of colleagues in here and also the panelists, that shares be offered in this institution we call West Indies cricket to be purchased by the Caribbean people with limits on the number of shares that individuals can buy.
All right, there you go. There you go. That's one point. The other point that we have to get at, because we don't want to run out of time. There was the subcommittee, I think the three prime ministers of Grenada, Antigua Barbuda, and St. Vincent and the Grenadines, suggested that the West Indies Cricket Board should be disbanded. I don't know if they could disband anything, I'm not certain. But the question I would like to ask everyone here, who owns West Indies Cricket? Oral, who owns West Indies Cricket?
Bertie, you showed me the paper you had. Yeah. And I pointed out to you that this was the only question on that paper I don't know the answer for. I don't know who owns West Indies Cricket.
Who owns West Indies Cricket? Is there one more, is it? I think there was a president that said the people didn't own West Indies Cricket.
The best analogy to answer that question is like a mutual assurance company. That basically it is owned by all the populations, but it means therefore that the board is not responsible to any small, narrow group of shareholders. It's responsible to everybody.
Bertis, I want to ask Dr. King something. Just based the suggestion just made a while ago, how feasible would that be, considering the stipulations of the ICC and all of that, of, you know, put offering West Indies Board on the market for public? The cricket, yeah. How feasible would that suggestion be? I'm not sure.
Well, the only way to answer that is if the prospectus were more fully spelled out, so it was clear what is your bank shares in and what the return would be.
Mm.
Otherwise, I'm not quite sure why anybody would put money into it.
Exactly.
What do you think, Deliver?
No, I don't really want to love the corner of that. So, Bill, are you back with us, sir?
No more.
So, Bill?
I'm listening. There's a whole lot of dribbling around. Sometimes it's pretty hard to.
I go back to the question that I asked you before. Tell me what you think should happen now. If you accept and agree that we do have problems in West Indies cricket, what do you think should happen now?
I believe that seeing that we would have created a path that I think maybe for the future, what the achievement of these individuals from the under 19, the ladies and the men. Listen, and it is of my view, and I'm not going to go away from that view. Everyone, there's some folks, you know, who would have heard on the panel spoke about maybe because we would have had this success. Let us move forward and let us all wrap whoever up in a blanket and move forward. We have problems administrative-wise, let's face it. We have problems. Let us see the best ways forward because of this success, how we are going to make the administration better, and can we do it with some of these individuals who is presently on board? Let us all forget the fact that, you know, even though it's under the board's watch, this particular achievement, let's not forget the embarrassment that we would have had. And it must have been the individuals who would have donned the West Indies colors to put aside all these matters that they would have had off field and decide, hey, we're going to do this for a much wider body, which is the Caribbean fan. And they did that. So let us look at the way now, how we can move forward. I don't think we can move forward presently with so many individuals who would have helped to put us in the quicksand.
Should the West Indies Cricket Board president step down?
What I can say, it is a huge problem in the region when you escalate a problem, especially when you do the right things or not. And I believe that we just have a huge problem in the region where, when it comes to resignations and things like that, it is a no-go.
Hmm. You resign when you win. You resign when you win.
No go. So which means the problems escalate over and over again.
Yeah, can you
hear
me?
Some of us who are in position at times, you know, who believe that if we bucked up, we should face up and manifest people and say, okay, we put whatever organization under whatever stress. It has been embarrassing for a number of years now. Maybe I didn't get things right. But why should we prolong to go along with some of these personalities who have failed us on numerous occasions?
Serviv, yes. The same individuals to which you refer, these are the same individuals who piloted us to two world titles in one day. Why are we so hung up on the negatives instead of building on the positives?
I am not.
disagreeing with this fact, but I'm saying that sometimes things can be achieved under due stress.
Well, maybe we need some more due stress because it's bringing us success.
Well, we would have heard Sammy speak about it, and that was when we would have had success also.
Carole, are you still there?
I have to decide what I want.
Are you still there, Carole? So we've lost that.
Yes, I am.
Back to the question that the Prime Minister suggested that the West Indies Cricket Board be disbanded. First question, and I think I know the answer. Do they have that power to do anything with West Indies Cricket?
Legally, they don't.
Right.
So, because the company is registered, duly registered as a business. It's a legal entity.
Yep. Who owns West Indies Cricket?
The Articles of Understanding does not allow for that kind of dissolution.
Who owns West Indies Cricket?
The West Indies Cricket belongs to the stakeholders, i.e. everybody in the Caribbean, but it is done through a structure.
Mm-hmm.
There are clubs and societies in each country that elect their national associations, of which two reps from the six distinct regions are represented at an annual general meeting / election. And that whole structure has been in train. I heard Wavell earlier talk about process. And here's another issue. We want change, but we're not prepared to do the work. And I'm saying if we want a structural change to West Indies Cricket Board and how it currently governs, when we have annual general meeting and we ask for papers to be brought down and so on, nobody speaks. And it's only in time of what we consider issues that we speak out. I can tell you, when you go to the club meetings, it's the same people that show up over and over, and so on. So I said, you know, if we want to voice our opinions in such a strong way, be part of the change. And there are opportunities for that. You can table agreements, you can table changes. But we're not prepared to go the extra mile. It's easier to point fingers.
All
I'm saying is, Neville, is that in agreeing, we're talking about moving forward. There's an election next year. So you have you have 11 months to talk to your respective territorial boards. There's an opportunity to contribute to cricket. But I have one suggestion, though. The formats of what the MVP and Racers Club have done in Jamaica with regards to that gap where we pick up the 18 to 25 age group, what the PCL and the expanded ODI tournaments in the region, the domestic tournaments are doing, is filling that gap. And it has only been 2 years, and I'm saying give that a chance.
All right, Dr. Cresser wants to say something.
I'm saying in the meantime, though, let's work in the background, do the negotiations as all the other leagues across the world do, and ensure that we meet the financial demand. But we need partnership for that.
Okay.
I wanted to jump in and take off from where Carol left off a while ago, but also to reconnect it to what our audience member Claremont said, because he asked a question about whether we as the Caribbean public are willing to buy shares in something called West Indies Cricket. You ask a question about who owns West Indies Cricket. I want to come back to that at the very end. I'll try to be very quick. I don't know what motivated the question. I'm thinking that we are hitting on the fact that in many ways the West Indies Cricket Board does not seem to answer to the people of the region, who in a real way, but also in a figurative way, own cricket. You are suggesting that maybe we formalize that arrangement. As it exists, though, there is one thing that I do want to say, is that there is a structure that allows the cricket public to participate in this entire process. But most people have taken themselves out of that. For instance, the West Indies Cricket Board is, in a sense, answerable to the territorial boards. And the territorial boards are elected by delegates from each of the registered clubs. So in Jamaica, each club sends delegates to the election. Now, how it should work is that at each club, there are elections. And 40, 50 years ago, when a club like Lucas had a thriving membership of 250 people and Kingston had a membership of 300 people, these are the people who would then elect the delegates who would make decisions. Now, in a sense, they would be answer. This is the way in which the cricket public demands answers. What has happened now is that Lucas Cricket Club may have 10 people. They are begging people to be on the executive. And these persons then become the delegates who elect the members of our territorial board. And if they have no one back at their club's answer to, that opens the door to many things. But the other thing that I want to say is, I don't know if you meant it, but that question about who owns West Indies cricket is a very serious question. Because the West Indies Cricket Board as a company is said that the shareholders, not the stakeholders, the shareholders are supposed to be the territorial boards. Now, if you remember, there was an incident with the Guyanese Cricket Board a few years ago.
Right.
And the case was to go to court, and when the case was to go to court, it was realized that the Guyanese Cricket Board was not an incorporated body. Because this, you know, goes back to the 1880s. Now, I have questions as to how a body that was not incorporated is a legal shareholder of the West Indies Cricket Board. So there are other very serious questions asked about who really owns this thing.
You had a question?
I have a question. After this, I'll shut up. And it speaks directly to the question of what is the way forward. You know, people in the football world look at the requirement that to play for the corresponding West Indies team, you have to play in the local tournament, the regional tournament for that particular format, before you can be eligible to be selected. The footballers look at that and just fall on the floor laughing. That, you know, you can't play for Jamaica unless you play your football in Jamaica. And I make the point because I seem to recall, and this is directed particularly at Mr. Hinds, I seem to recall that that rule came in 1970s. Before you had all of these opportunities to go all over the world and play cricket, and it came in to solve the problem that the test players would come back to the Caribbean, and rather than play in the regional competition, they would rather go back and lie on their beds and watch TV because they were tired and they couldn't be bothered. And so it was obligating them to play some cricket in between the test tours. That is not the situation we have now. The situation we have now is that they have too much cricket to play. So that requirement seems to just be a legacy of a previous irrelevant time in the world of cricket. And therefore, is it not time, Mr. Hinds, as the representative of the players, for you to take that rule change to the West Indies board and say, once a West Indies player is playing cricket somewhere else in the corresponding format, he's therefore match ready and should be eligible for selection to the West Indies team?
Mr. Hinds?
And thanks, Dr. King. I believe that your summation of the situation is accurate. I think you probably would have left out one key component to that is the WICB's obligations to its commercial partners. And if you know, trying to get commercial entities to come on board in any sport at all requires that they would want brand value. And for them to have value, they need to have the best players playing the competition to showcase and to bring about and add, you know, make sure that their brand is being treated in a particular way with the best players. So your argument has a lot of merit to it, of course, but certainly the other flip side to it is to have the West Indies board looking after the commercial brand value of their partners, certainly. And as well, part of what you said is in it, for me, where I would have gained from it is to have when I started to play, have a Jimmy Adams and a Courtney Walsh playing, when they come back and decide to play for Jamaica with me, I am pleased as a punch to go on the field with them, and I want to perform and impress them, and they will be guiding me throughout the 4 days of a four-day game as to what to do. So there is value added on both sides, and I think it's a good argument, a good discussion to have. I certainly do have a problem with somebody doing the relevant stuff, playing the corresponding format outside of the Caribbean, and certainly making themselves available when the international comes. And the flip of that is that the person must also be willing to give up some of playing outside to come back and make sure I help the rest of his board to add value to their commercial partners and teach a youngster who is going to replace in 5 years' time what to do so that when the time comes for renewal, that we have competent and capable persons to sit in the dressing room and carry out their duties accordingly.
All right, another question from Twitter. Do we need more local clubs in individual countries? Should there be
incentives for entrepreneurs slash companies to build local clubs. Who wants to take that one?
I think you missed, you have lost us. Hello?
Are you still, I'm hearing you now, Carole. I hope you could hear us.
I just wanted to just add something very quickly to what Wavell just said.
Sure.
As the T20 and some of the other competitions emerge over the years, we have made gaps. We have made those spaces available. So for example, the fact that the four-day PCL starts in November until December, takes a break, then resumes after the one day. We had a gap for the IPL and our own CPL here in the region. The Pakistan Super League, which just started, falls right after our ODI and just before preparation for World Cup. So we're already doing that. I just think that the negotiations with regards to the pay disputes need to be a little more open. And I think there are some things that we need to adopt, and those discussions will happen in June. The existing relationships, though, will run out this summer. And so come September 1, 2016, going forward, some of those adjustments will be made. So I just want to make that clear. So the fact that there's no tournament in April, which is now, all the players that are available are going to and can make the IPL are there. Also, some of our players who could have been eligible for our June tournament have already no objection certificates and have signed contracts with clubs across the world for other tournaments. And so we there is a balance that's being struck, but it is changing so rapidly, and we have to be clear on those timelines.
Okay,
on your question of the clubs.
No, maybe you wanted to jump. Okay, go ahead.
On the question of the clubs.
Mm-hmm.
You would have to look right across the Caribbean, because certainly in the case of Jamaica, it's not that we need more clubs, but you know what the situation is. There are just one or two clubs who are really holding the ground. We need to have a very serious look at club structure now, because it has serious implications. I think it was Damien who made the point as to who are the people, and it was certainly amplified by Julian, who are the people really representing us, the people we are throwing forward to go to the West Indies board, right? So that we get really serious business going on there, not people saying, well, I'm a member of the West Indies board because I represent Jamaica.
Yeah.
But right across the board, if you look at the Barbados setup, the Trinidad setup, right? We need more uniformity in the thing. We need to be able to copy best practices that are going on in some of these islands. The Windwards and the Leewards, serious work needs to be done down there.
All right,
on the way forward, Bertis, I have to say this. Some major challenges lie ahead in terms of the way forward. We're going to have to choose to dream along, or we're going to have to be pragmatic about it. Personally, I think Test cricket is actually dying. I think T20 cricket, unlike what some of the purists say, T20 cricket is not here to destroy West Indies cricket. It's here to save West Indies cricket. I'm on the opposite end of the spectrum to Dr.
Hold on.
I'm on the opposite end.
No, you're not on the opposite.
I don't like Test cricket anymore. I don't like Test cricket anymore.
As far as
I'm a T20 fan. I am a T20 man. I think T20 is here to save West Indies cricket. Yep. And I think, look, if you look at the thing practically, you see, when you lose the passion of the players for a particular format of the game, Bertis, we're swimming against the tide. The young players in the region not interested in playing Test cricket anymore. They're not even interested in watching it. When they see Chris Gayle, they see Andre Russell, they see Dwayne Bravo, these guys are billionaire superstars, not out of Test cricket. Not out of Test cricket, but out of T20 cricket. And the next generation of players, coming up, you're going to have to force them to play Test cricket. And I think that is not practical.
Just before Dr. Cresser, you say that to say what?
The way forward is T20 cricket.
Who was
the player that played? Curtis, your first contact thing for the night.
Yeah.
There is no way back for the West Indies in Test cricket. There is no way back. If you look at the dynamics of the game and how the game is evolving, not just locally, but it's evolving internationally, but it's evolving at a faster rate in the region where our top players, where will them coping with the problem now? The top players, they are not eligible to play for the West Indies in the longer version of the game. You know why? Because they are not interested. They disqualify themselves by not playing 4-day cricket or even 1-day cricket. The man that want to play T20 cricket will make them money. And I don't see it as a problem. I see it as redemption.
It's not fair to say they're not interested.
They're not.
It's just, no,
some of them aren't.
Just like to have the thing so tailored that they can be eligible to play.
Hold on.
Give
me a second. Some of them are not. Some of them are not interested.
Sir Vim, I think you, you want to get involved in here? In this? Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, man.
Go ahead, Sir Vim.
Can I say something?
Yeah, man, please.
Yeah, listen. I do take the sentiments of that individual, you know, who is basically into the fast food of things.
Yeah.
Let me say this. Why is it maybe the players may be gravitating to the fact that they are involved so much with the T20? That's the question. Why is it that is Australia, England, and South Africa, this game is still strong? Can someone answer me, please?
I can't take that one. The T20 cricket is a natural fit for the athleticism, the speed, and the power of the Caribbean athlete. It's a perfect fit. Right, it's a perfect fit and it's perfect timing. The Australians are more.
Hold on.
Please,
moderator, if I could.
Please, I'm going to jump in. Sir, go ahead. Finish your point, sir.
The last one.
Anyone here?
The players of.
Go ahead, sir. Ben.
And as well in England, Australia, that maybe because of the strength of the players.
It's a dream. It's a dream, you know. It's a dream, and we're all free to dream. We all have our dreams. But it's not just the physical prowess of the Caribbean athlete that is compatible with T20 cricket. You know. Mentally, we are locked onto the shorter version.
So
I wanted to ask another question and we can come back to it. I just wanted to know whether any of the other cricketing countries are having similar difficulties and with their players and
how they manage to solve it. And can we learn any lessons from difficulties which other countries have? Coming on to this T20 issue. I just want to know what you mean by similar difficulties. Exactly what you're talking
about. With their players, difficulties between their management organization and their players, whether the English and the Indians and so on, and what lessons can we learn from how they got around that? So are there similar quarrels in India at the moment, in England, in South Africa, and Australia? Have there been recently? And what was done? Have they found a solution? And can we learn from any of those situations? Second point is on is with Tracy. I suppose you should say we shouldn't play classical music anymore or jazz. Well, you know, Test cricket is not for everybody. I begin by saying that it's not for everybody. Nor is jazz.
Nor is music.
But there are some fundamental things about Test cricket which develops the game of cricket, which it is based on. You may have heard on your manager last night, who was talking about the music and tracing the music. And you can't disband where the music is coming from. There are some skills that you learn in Test cricket that you learn in T20. I don't agree with you.
Yes.
Even though Stephanie
Taylor
says she would love to play Test cricket.
Yes.
And there is a side to most of us, which yearns after what Test cricket is. which yeah. 2020 can
yeah, but we have to be practical about.
So what I want to talk about this thing about a fit.
The what?
Fit between yep. our athleticism
yep. yep. yep.
2020. Mm-hmm. So what about the Warriors and the Weeks?
That was a different generation. That was a different generation.
No,
I'm being pragmatic. What? I'm being pragmatic. That was a different generation. The athleticism hasn't changed. But there was no T20 then. There was no T20 then paying the amount of money now. That's a game changer, you know, Dr. King. The money is the game changer. This is a different generation. This is an instant gratification generation. And you're not going to convince these guys to play 5 days of cricket for $5,000.
Yeah, go ahead, we're hearing you, sir.
Hello?
We're hearing you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you guys got a little blurry, so you're not blurry.
We're hearing you loud and clear. What is your point, sir?
I can't hear you, sir. I can't hear that good.
Yeah.
Bertis.
Yeah, hang on.
Turn that off. Yeah, go ahead with your point, sir. Still not hearing us?
Hello?
Yep. You still can't hear us?
I can hear you now.
Yeah, go ahead with your point, sir.
What was the question?
No, you wanted to come in. You were talking about...
No, the thing that I asked, it's only in the Caribbean we are the ones who have this mindset or thoughts about giving up maybe that version for this particular person. The Australians, they're as strong as anything else they hate it. You keep on watching the massive start of the world. You'll be thinking that you'll be... attending at T20 match as well. Okay? That is just as important as anything else.
But it is true that a lot of people, well, certainly locally, a lot of people don't watch Test cricket. That is a fact. I'm not suggesting that we should disband it, but that is a fact. So how do you get the crowds back to watch Test cricket?
If you go to Australia, England, and also South Africa, and they are three members of the ICC.
Okay, we have another comment here, sir. I'll hold a mic for you.
Yes. I'm Leon Campbell. We are representing Jamaica. In terms of the cricket, Test cricket versus T20, so we've hinted to it earlier that the West Indian player can play any version of cricket. We were born to play cricket. In early days, we just played cricket. We didn't think about no T20 or whatever version. The Stephanie Taylor that I see out there, it pains me sometimes to see this kind of stroke that she play and get out. The semi-final that she played and that stroke that she got out of, she shouldn't be playing a stroke like that. Stephanie, it's runs play cricket. And once you're making the runs, it don't matter if you hit the ball over the fence or if you play it on the ground, as Lawrence Rowe demonstrated. But once we're not winning, people will not come out to say any much.
So you think we should continue with Test cricket?
Moderator, may I jump in?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, I mean, we're having, I think, two different discussions. Because what is not in any doubt is that we have the capacity to play Test cricket and to play it well. What is also not in any doubt is that Test cricket, as the gentleman suggested, provides a foundation, allows for the development of certain skills which are just necessary regardless of the format.
Thank you.
But the question that we have to ask, and I think why we're about at this point, is really and truly what we're asking right now is, can we in the West Indies afford it? Part of the problem why we have the problem with WIPA and the West Indies Cricket Board is very simply that we have had to try and redistribute the limited income that we have to try and fund. It is different for other countries, for instance, and the English and Wales Cricket Board, when they sign a deal with Sky or whoever else it is to broadcast their matches, including their county cricket, their NatWest T20 Blast, their 40 over, their 50 over, and they get tens of, if not hundreds of millions of pounds of these contracts. That is what they then use to subsidize a lot of their first-class cricket. I'm not saying that we should not, or I would not like us. I love Test cricket. I hate T20. I'm saying practically, what faces us right now is how are we going to afford continuing playing T20 and Test cricket. And that is not going to be possible without some type of compromise and sacrifice.
Actually, I'm taking a middle ground. The two are not mutually exclusive. I think we should rebrand the cricket. Test cricket become the incubator and we make money from T20. I think that's what we should, because if we rebrand the cricket, we can get people into this into the stands. Because the problem we have with Test cricket, it dull and drab for the post modern generation who don't have time to sit down and watch 5 days at
Precisely.
So if we rebrand the cricket, make it interesting. Dancing girl.
Day night. Day night cricket.
But I think
day night Test cricket.
The two are not mutually exclusive.
No.
West Indies cricket can benefit both from the Test cricket and both from T20. What do we do? The Test cricket become the incubator and the T20 one again.
No, good.
Different
and
skills.
And the same in very different skills. So. But that's exactly what's happening. That's exactly what is happening all over, where T20 cricket is subsidizing Test cricket. Part of the problem for us in the Caribbean, though, is whereas IPL can fund so much of what India needs, who runs our CPL, which would then be the income generator to fund the rest of the cricket?
Serviv?
That's another question.
Serviv?
Serviv?
Hello?
Yeah, can you hear me, Serviv?
Yeah, I can hear some of these discussions a bit.
Yeah, so we must play Test cricket. How do we get this West Indies Test cricket team back where everyone thinks we should be?
That was the clue. That was about early to become Test match cricketers, and then all the performers were in the juice. We had the 50 over. Now we have the shortened 20. This is what was happening before. All these other formats came in off the back end of Test match cricket. So it would be nice. To hear the panel's discussion, because everyone seems to think that's the way to go now. But cricket was built on a background, which was Test match cricket, and then we took various into the other version.
Quite difficult to hear, sir, Viv, because of the interference, for want of a better word. But let me ask the panel, Wavell Hinds. West Indies opening batsman, I think what, 5 centuries? Am I right?
Yeah.
No,
only that?
What do you think? Let's look at this Test cricket thing. What do you think? We have to really expand on the West Indies Test team for sure. How do we get the West Indies Test team to be as successful as we've known them? I think it was 1995 when the West Indies lost to Australia. Before that, I thought that we lapped it, I suppose, like 1979, 1980
against New Zealand.
It was 15 years before. We hadn't lost a test series, so they never lost a test series as captain. How do we feel about that?
Well, firstly, let me declare my position that Test cricket must be played. I believe that it is the purest format. I'm sorry, well, Tracey, but I'm not really on that one. And Mr. Cresser, I know that you love the game, but certainly you're saying that the tide is going in the direction of T20. So I'm saying, how are we going to pay for it? All right. I just believe that using the T20 and the 50-over formats to keep that general interest and to give the younger generation that immediate sort of excitement and success will certainly be the platform. But putting in the right infrastructure, getting the right human resources, upskilling our coaches and packaging the game is certainly the way to go for Test cricket. Test cricket provides all cricketers, or the younger version provides all cricketers with the fundamentals that you need to execute in any version of the game that they play. And if you do the analysis and see the persons who are excited and who are successful in Test cricket, you'll see that they are the ones who would have been very good, the ones who are successful in T20, the guys barring a David Warner who came the opposite way through T20 into Test cricket. The ones, the Chris Gales, Chris will have had an immaculate Test record before he became
a
No, I don't finish as yet, if you allow me though. Thanks for interrupting. And I'm certainly saying that the way to go, we'll have to start from the ICC. The ICC will have to make it their point of duty to put more funding to their member boards,
to come down to test cricket. There's a payment paid out now to test cricket. I don't think it's sufficient. There should be a very deliberate act by the ICC to make sure that the individual boards get the kind of funding to go into the schools, right through to the clubs, up right to the test teams, to make sure that test cricket is the way forward. I'm sure that WICB, as it is now, should make that sort of a deliberate move to make sure that we are preparing a test team, give the flexibility. I want to believe that Craig Bratchett is leaning towards being one of our better openers if he is allowed to develop and given the support over the next 10 years. I think he has a temperament and he's growing in stature, and I think the ICC and the WICB must look in that direction to be deliberate about what they do with test cricket. Once the T20 and the one day teams are doing well and the test team is growing good, you will see that the West Indies, when they play England and Australia, as it is now with the Ashes, that we have full stadium to the Ashes because we have fully developed teams. The Australians start to develop their players from about 8 years old, right through and through, with proper coaching, not just organized ramping, as I call it. Just don't get guys on the weekend to just play cricket and brand them and say, oh, grassroots cricket and running. No, proper coaching, and you lock them and you follow them and you track them with different numbers right throughout the region. Don't forget the sociology of this and the cultural side. That we are the only country, and with our uniqueness, that we're not one mainland. We have about 14 sovereign nations that make up the West Indies. That doesn't happen in any sport at all. I'm sure that the game will certainly be reignited, and the version will be reignited, and the mounds will fold for a test cricket again, and people want to do 4 days.
Let me ask you this, I understand exactly what you just said. I don't know if that happened when Sir Vivian played, when Michael Holden played, when Cody Walsh played. Mm-hmm. And you keep hearing that we don't have the talent anymore, and those were just really talented cricketers. Is this a talent thing here?
No. Not it's fundamentally, Bertis, the game is evolving. The game has evolved. We have the most talented players now in T20 cricket. Because that is where the passion lies with the youngsters and the developing players. That how you reconcile? How Wavell and Dr. King and all the lovers of test cricket, how do you reconcile empty stadiums, except for the Ashes? That's the only test series that has any relevance now in world cricket.
I just watched South Africa versus England.
There was
and it was a very good series.
Let me make my general point.
So that's one.
You can continue to swim against the tide. Okay? But I want him to reconcile from Bertie. The dwindling numbers who attend test cricket, right? Compare that to the massive numbers and the kind of atmosphere that you see at T20. You go watch Jamaica playing 4-day cricket and then go back down the next month when TPL start and look at the disparity and smell the coffee. There's another thing that you need to reconcile again. Marlon Samuels said it in a TV interview the other day. How you reconcile playing a player looking at his future as a cricketer, as a professional cricketer, and the option of earning $5,000 US dollars plus to go and run up and down for 5 days in the hot sun, or earn $100,000 to go play 3 hours of cricket in the afternoon. How you reconcile that? Smell the coffee.
All right.
Smell the coffee.
By the way, when we keep in mind that there is a friend of mine, so we actually went in a little accident just before we started, and he's actually in hospital. He has a finger injury, so he's actually
sleeping. What's that music, man?
He's starting to smile.
Apparently,
that's the reason the interference.
Go ahead, Sir Viv. We're hearing you. Very strong for someone in hospital. We're hearing you. Sir Viv?
Hi.
I think we've lost him again.
No, the conversation is quite good, you know. It is great to hear, you know, this sort of thing. And this is why you have guys and guys who are obese. Test match cricket is the major concern. They are various formats, and we are extremely good at the T20 stuff. Yep. Let's not forget that.
Okay. Okay.
So Bertis, may I just add something though? As much as
hold on 1 second, because we are out of here in about 13 minutes. And we really want to end up with some positives. What do we do going forward?
So final comment on if there's an issue there, and then we'll get a comment from everyone as how we go forward.
I just wanted to say it. We have to be careful about when we judge the popularity of test cricket to base it simply on attendance. Now, I am somewhat on Oral Tracy's side in terms of practically we have to really think about the future viability of test cricket. However, I want to say though that test cricket, the audience of test cricket is different now simply because obviously lifestyles have changed. So whereas the stadium may be empty when a test match is being played, you have millions following on television, and of course television rights contributes a lot, and you also have lots of people following online, whether it is by a streamer you go on Cricket Info or BBC and you get the live update. So we have to be careful about judging the popularity of test cricket solely on attendance in the stadium, because people don't have the time to come up for 5 days, but millions are watching on TV and following online.
All right, anyone else here with a comment, a question? Anyone else here? No? All right. Sure, I'm coming to you, sir.
It's a repetition. What is the experience of other federations when they run into difficulties with their players? How have they solved those problems? And can we learn anything from the other federations?
Mr. Hines, could you take that?
Well, it's purely through engagement. There must be a conversation in a very, very toned manner. And I believe that we want to head in that direction. We should head in that direction. The association that I represent is pretty open to having dialogue with guys who have not been supportive of the association in the recent past, and for guys who have benefited from the association in the not too distant past as well. So I think it's dialogue. I've had consistent discussions with WICB. I've reached out to players who are not members of the association, and I think it's just to have a very tell it all, speak the truth discussion, and have everybody put their position on the tables and understanding what West Indies really is facing. When we start to negotiate at the West Indies Player Association, we start negotiations with the WICB audited financial statement. So I don't want anybody to tell me that they don't have any money or they have this. No, let the auditors tell me. And that's where we start. And then we start as to what are your actual commercial revenue that you make. And then we see what the commercial revenues are, and then we negotiate the percentage that goes to the player payment pool. And what goes to the player payment pool, on average, is $30.5 million per year. And that is divided between all the players who play professional cricket in the Caribbean. And that amount goes as 57% goes to the international players, which will amount to about $17.4 million. And then the other $13.1 million goes to the domestic players. Now, if you follow the game, you know that you have some international players who play all three formats. Like Adenis Ramdin will play all three formats. And then you have some guys who just play T20 or one day alone. So we may have about 30 players on the international scene for the three formats. We have about 150 male cricketers actively playing cricket in the Caribbean. So that will leave another 120 to share up $13.1 million, which is 43% of that, to be split across 90 contracted players. Those are players who will have guaranteed salaries. And then we have another set of players, another 30 set of players who will certainly be playing on a pay-per-play contract. So whenever they are selected and play, they are remunerated accordingly.
I don't know if you could answer this, but an idea of how much a senior cricketer would make per year?
So if I analyze the salaries, which will include, when I speak about domestic cricket, I spoke now about the 4-day and 50 over. Now, a lot of discussions have been had around the Caribbean, and people seem to always exclude the CPL from it. Please to remember that the CPL is the West Indies Cricket Board's domestic T20 competition. So for all the guys who played in the recent T20 World Cup, which we are proud of and their win, they will have had to participate in the CPL to be eligible for a selection to go. Okay. Now, if we analyze the salaries,
The lowest paid person at the development level in the CPA would have gotten about $4,000, and the highest paid person would have gotten $160,000. In the CPL, in the 4-day competition slash 50 over for the WICB, a contract is $30,000, a B contract is $20,000, and a C contract is $15,000. The match fees for the 4-day competition is $1,300 for 4-day cricket and $700 for 50 over cricket. Now the retainers, as I labeled before, for the senior West Indies players are 150 A plus, 135 A, 125 B plus, 115 B, and 100,000 for C. So I'm just saying that if you take the top guy who's 150,000 for the West Indies and he's the top guy in the CPL, that's 310 already. And then you do that if you play as all first round. Test match fees, $5,000. Test match fees, $5,750. ODI fees, $2,300. And T20 fees, $1,750. And those are the numbers I go across. And the pool that I spoke about does not mention what we deal with in terms of our women cricketers. And if we're going to move cricket forward, like I said before, are we dealing with gender equality? I believe that a fair day's pay, work deserve a fair day's pay. And the women are playing the same 50 over competition in the same hot sun according to World Tracy and deserve to be remunerated accordingly. Mm-hmm. Now, presently, what our women cricketers get for international cricket is less than what our male cricketers get for regional cricket. Now, that is not, there's no equity in that at all. So, we are presently in negotiations given that they came on board in 2014 with us. We have improved their one day their regional fees already. They used to get, and I'm not proud to say it, but I have to, and ladies, please forgive me, that they're in the play of regional cricket. The great Stefani Taylor that we are so loved, and when she represents Jamaica and they play regional cricket. If a tournament lasts for 15 days, they get $150. That's $10 a day. That's what they used to get. No. And so we have negotiated those or renegotiated those. They now get $167 for a 50 over game per game and $125 per T20 game. And we're in the position of moving their international fees, which are at present $500 for a 50 over game and $300 for a T20 game. Okay. When they played in the recent T20 World Cup, they were able to be given the T20, they're given sponsorship on their shirts for the first time since they've been playing.
Yeah.
For the first time. So we're trying to create equity, and we believe that a fair day's work is our fair day's pay. So we're moving that direction.
Final comment.
We are just focusing on the money. I never got the idea that it was just a money problem with West Indies cricket. I mean, we hear about lack of trust and transparency and communication and all of those issues. So it's not just a money issue. So, I'm
a bit concerned that, because the suggestion is if we get a whole pile of money, everything will be fine. But I don't think that's true.
No, all of that you said, I think you read it right. It is a money issue. Those issues you mentioned, the trust, lack of trust and all that, they're all peripheral to the money issue. Don't let nobody fool you.
All right, we have 5 minutes, and I'll get a comment from everyone here. We have 1 minute, no more than 1 minute, and a final comment. Dr. Cresser.
Final comment. The question is the way forward. I honestly think that if we are going to continue playing all formats of the game, that the way forward is the path that is presently being pursued by the West Indies Cricket Board in terms of redistributing money. It is going to require the players to make some compromise for it to work. But I will also say this, you can do the right thing, but you can do it the wrong way. And I said, I think, in private to Wavell a couple of years ago about the West Indies board president, and I'll say it publicly, that I honestly think that he is trying to do some good things, but sometimes I don't think the way in which he has gone about it has gone down well with the players, which is where those issues that were just mentioned a while ago comes in, and maybe that is where a lot of the problems lies. So, we try, and I think in many ways to do the right thing, but we have to think about how it was done and can we save the situation.
Mr. Dolphin, turn the mic on, please, sir.
think that one of the things that we need to address right now, the bodies, the relevant bodies need to get together to look at this old rule, this eligibility rule. I think it's something that needs to be really fleshed out because, you know, it's been a long time. This thing is age old. In addition to which, you have the money, of course, you can't sidestep that. But again, as I said earlier, I think that there's a third component in this whole organizational structure that is calling for the UWI to get involved. We need to get involved in this because at long last UWI is taking sports seriously, and this is across the entire set of campuses, and I think that there's a role for us to play in terms of the way forward for West Indies cricket.
Okay, the pragmatic way forward and not the emotional way forward. I use a track and field analogy. We're the sprint kings of the world, eh? We don't try run marathon and steeplechase and road race and all them something. See, T20 is here to save West Indies cricket. It's not here to destroy West Indies cricket. All stakeholders and people who love cricket, I'm sure what we felt 2 weeks ago when we won both titles is no different than we felt 30 years ago when we were kings of the world. It's the same pride and joy and confidence that we feel. And I think if T20 offers that, we should go get it and try and maintain, try and go for a dynasty in T20 cricket instead of trying to dilute what we do by trying to be all things to all men.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks. I believe that the present landscape and what exists with the WICB and the Players Association is, as Dr. Julian Cresser said, is the right way to, in terms of developing our game and, of course, producing international players of high quality. Also, I will impress upon the WICB to make sure that they continue to grow their commercial revenue. They have a great platform with the three winning teams from the 19s through the ladies and then the men. And certainly that can lay the platform for great negotiations. And of course, the landscape is an ever-changing one, so the governance structure of the West Indies comes into play. And so Horton Dolphin's position about the eligibility rule comes into question, and those things must be reviewed on a continuous basis since the landscape of the game keeps changing at a rapid pace.
Okay. I saw what I was going to ask you. What, you're going to step down?
I was elected by a body, a duly elected, and I served that body and followed the mandate of that body. I have just answered it, sir. You maybe not get the answer you want.
So, Viv, are you with us still? Carole, is Carole with us? So it seems we've lost them. Well, that's it. Want to thank you all so very much for coming here. On behalf of Professor Ian Boxin, the Director of the Center for Tourism and Policy Research, and this was put on in association with the Department of Sociology, Psychology, and Social Work, and the Department of Government right here at the University of the West Indies. It was fantastic for me. Great to see my sister, Lilibet. I'm the only one. This is not a part of the forum, so thank you so very much for coming. I thought it was quite informative. And I think all of us, at the end of the day, just want to see West Indies cricket where it ought to be. I remember, because I'm in the media, I remember what happened, how I felt at Sabina Park in 1995 when we lost our first test series. I remember that. I actually cried. I couldn't believe it. And I want us to get back there. And I think we can. I think we can. Yeah. Well, now I know why we lost. Mr. Dolphin was the liaison officer for the Australian team. So you gave them our secrets. But it's a fantastic game, and it's probably the only game in the world that could do something like what we had today to get these wonderful comments and the emotion from Cantankerous number one and then Cantankerous number two. Again, not a part of the forum, but we are now joined by Savannah Peridot, who is a we'll make a few presentations. Me first? Oh.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone, or good evening. We've come to the end of our program, and we'd like to thank our moderator, Neville Bell, and our panelists, of course, Horton Dolphin, Oral Tracy, Wavell Hinds, Julian Cresser, and of course, Sir Viv and Carole Beckford, who joined us, but they couldn't be here tonight, but they joined us via Skype and on the phone. So we'd like to give you all a token of our, to show our appreciation. So, would you, okay. So, Neville, you said you wanted to be first. Okay, Wavell Hinds. Oral Tracy.
Why?
Horton Dolphin. And last but not least, Julian Cresser. Okay, and don't forget, we have cocktails outside, everyone. Thank you so much for coming, and thank you so much for participating in this very spirited discussion. Thank you.
That's it, folks. Thanks again, and be safe going home. God bless.